from our homes in the United States.
To the homeland of Christianity in Egypt.
To Mount Sinai, St. Catherine's Monastery.
To the islands of Greece and the holy Mount Athos.
To Eastern Europe.
Deep in the forests of Romania, with its numerous monasteries and convents. Ukraine, the ancient Pechersky Lavra.
And Russia's holy place, Sergiev Posad. We begin a modern pilgrimage like the ancients, leaving behind civilization to seek the wisdom and peace of the desert.
Egypt is the mother of monasticism. The monastic life began here in Egypt. We feel that the monastic life is backing the church, is supporting the church. Of course, every person in the world needs the calmness of the desert, not only the monks or the nuns. In the crowdness of the world, we don't see ourselves and we don't see God. But when we be in a calmness, especially in the holy places, we begin to look to ourselves, to look to the deepness of our relation with God, to feel God, to hear God.
A great monastery arose at the foot of St. Anthony's Cave. It was built in 356, the oldest active monastery in the world. It's been plundered and rebuilt several times.
We have been given the rare invitation to share evening vespers with the monks.
After a few moments, one monk jumped up and whispered in my ear, "God told me you were coming. Come up to my cave on the mountainside and bring your cameras." It was getting too dark, so we went into an ancient chapel right in front of St. Anthony's tomb and sat down to talk.
If I had the sort of love which is overflowing, Christian love, agape, which is overflowing for everybody, if I had it already as a blessing, as a grace, I could have stayed among the people. But I was weak. I needed time, I needed prayer, I needed help. For me personally to rise up from, I was atheist before I went to the monastery. So I needed to go a long journey from Marxism and atheism and existentialism, which was all keeping me, all the isms keeping me far away from God. Some people need this time to sit alone at the feet of God and feel His grace.
Is silence important to you?
Naturally.
What do you hear, what do you see, feel in silence?
Well, first of all, there are kinds of silence. Silence can mean not speaking, stay in a place which is quiet.
Yes.
This is helpful. Like, it's nice to go into a nice forest or a nice garden where you are away from traffic.
Helping you to be quiet.
But this is an exterior silence, which it helps you, okay? It helps you to breathe slowly, to enjoy the aesthetic pleasure, mm-hmm. the beauty of the creation. But it's transient, it will not last. There's another kind of silence, which is interior silence. Now, this is much harder to find, but it's long-lasting. For example, here we're living in the desert. Okay, I'm living up there in the mountain. For long periods of time, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 month, I don't see any people, only when I come down here. I'm not doing anything particularly wrong. Really. I'm not committing sins of action daily, right? I'm just sitting quietly and working and praying and being alone. But what about my mind? If I don't have interior silence, I can be as busy in my mind as if I was in New York.
So what do you do? How do you get internally silent?
By prayer, by Jesus prayer.
Could you tell us about the Jesus prayer?
The Jesus prayer is Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy
upon me, forgive me,
or,
help me.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. The short form and the long form, it doesn't matter. Now, this prayer, when you repeat it many times, okay, when you use it as a prayer rule, as a discipline, because it's the same words repeated, and because it focuses on the name of Jesus, this prayer starts to diminish, not accelerate your thoughts. Your thoughts, your desires, your plans, your projects, all of this is stilled. Okay, it will come. After you stop praying, it will come back. You have to start praying again. So what I'm talking about, the interior silence, it's a question of stilling the voices which are speaking inside you. Most of my life is struggle. I must fight against temptations. I must fight against weakness. So I actually think that the truest spiritual life is not permanent peace with calm and no worry. This can be a state of delusion. The truest spiritual life, the best spiritual life, is one where there are these moments of peace. The Lord grants them because He loves us. But a lot of the time we struggle, we fight. By this, we show the Lord that we are on the way to Him. We are doing something for Him, even as He struggled for us.
Father Lazarus says some prayers for our journey, and we're off. Our next stop, St. Catherine's Monastery at the foot of Mount Sinai. Fathers and the spiritual elder of the monastery, Father Pavlos.
Ο Άγιος Αμπάς Δωρόθεος γράφει στα σχετικά του ότι είναι το μισό της πνευματικής ζωής, η ειρήνη της ψυχής. Δηλαδή, αν χάσει ο άνθρωπος την ειρήνη της ψυχής, έχασε το μισό από την πνευματική του ζωή. Και πώς θα αποκτήσει μετά αυτό το μισό που έχασε? Ασφαλώς είναι κατορθωτό, δεν είναι ακατόρθωτο, διότι δεν θα το ζητούσε ο Θεός αν ήταν ακατόρθωτο. Θέλει όμως προσοχή. Αυτό είναι το μυστικό της. Δηλαδή πρέπει να προσέχει ο άνθρωπος και ο μοναχός, αλλά και ο άνθρωπος που ζει στον κόσμο. Μετά η εν Χριστώ ζωή είναι κάτι το εσωτερικό, δεν είναι κάτι το εξωτερικό. Είναι θέμα να γυρίσει ο άνθρωπος, να σκύψει στην καρδιά του. Εκεί είναι το μυστικό. Και αν ειρηνεύσει μέσα του εσωτερικά, ειρηνεύει και με τον κόσμο και με τους άλλους ανθρώπους. Και βέβαια ο βασικός σκοπός είναι να αγωνιστεί, να καθαρίσει την καρδιά του από την αμαρτία. Διότι όταν υπάρχει αμαρτία, υπάρχει και ταραχή στον άνθρωπο. Όσο προχωράει στην αρετή, κόβει τα πάθη, έρχεται και είναι καρπός. Η ειρήνη της ψυχής έρχεται μέσα στην ψυχή του μετά. Λέει ο Άγιος Ιωάννης Κλίμακος στο έργο του ότι κάποτε πήγε σε μια ομάδα με ολίγους ασκητάς και πέρασε και άκουσε ταραχή φωνή μέσα στο ασκητήριο. Και ανοίγει την πόρτα και μπαίνει μέσα και τους λέει: «Τι θα σας ωφελήσει έρημος εδώ πέρα? Δεν πάτε να φύγετε από εδώ?» Λέει δηλαδή ότι ο άνθρωπος αν δεν προσέξει και στην έρημο να είναι, θα τη χάσει την ειρήνη. Εάν προσέξει και στον κόσμο μέσα να είναι, θα τη διατηρήσει.
We're standing in the new sacristy of the monastery at Sinai, and in this room are contained the oldest Christian icons in existence. This is a veritable treasure house of Christian antiquity. The most famous of all hesychast images of the Lord, the Pantocrator of Sinai. The face is painted on a chiasmus to show the combination of judgment, a severe judgment of the world, but also the great compassion of God. And the two sides, the severe side and the gentle side, combine, and the hand brings it all together in a blessing upon the world, a blessing of peace.
The significance of Christ's hand is important. He's making the letters from his perspective. I C X C.
And the fingers make, those letters make the word Jesus the Christ, Jesus Christos. So the name of God is giving the blessing.
From the islands of Greece, we fly north to Eastern Europe, to Romania, following the progression of Christians since the fall of Constantinople in 1453. Here at Sâmbătă de Sus Monastery lives a very famous spiritual master, Father Teofil, who has been without sight since his birth.
He's a very prolific theological author and graciously invites us to his cell for some words of wisdom.
Preocuparea oamenilor care se roagă să facă o legătură între minte și inimă, între puterea care gândește și puterea care iubește. Coborârea în minții în inimă, de fapt, nu o face omul, ci o face Dumnezeu. Deci noi ne rugăm lui Dumnezeu pentru unitatea ființei noastre. Când am început să zic Doamne Iisuse Hristoase, Fiul lui Dumnezeu, m-am întâlnit cu mizeria din sufletul meu și m-a luat groasa. Am avut și chestiuni pozitive. Să am uneori atâta bucurie și eram sigur că nu pot suporta mai multă bucurie, ci mi-o dădea Dumnezeu.
Shortly after our visit, we learned the news that Father Teofil had gently fallen asleep in the Lord.
Well, here we are at St. Anne's Monastery at Rochia in Transylvania. It's called by the people the Holy Mountain of the North.
Like Mount Athos.
Exactly.
Way in the back of the little church, my eye catches an elderly monk. Turns out he's Father Seraphim, the former spiritual master and abbot of St. Anna's. He's now the monastery's librarian, with decades of wisdom behind his gentle demeanor.
Rugăciunea e pâinea sufletului, e gura raiului, e gura îngerilor. Rugându-te, ne asemnăm cu îngerii care mereu laudă pe Dumnezeu. De aceea, trebuie neapărat să ne rugăm neîncetat. Cel mai mare dușman al rugăciunii e diavolul. Că ne punem să ne rugăm, mereu ne aduce aminte de diferite lucruri care trebuie să le facem. Deci toți sfinții mereu a fost în contemplație, în gândire cu Dumnezeu. Tot ce ne înconjoară, ne vorbește de Dumnezeu. Fenomenul Dumnezeu a văzut Duhului ca pământul să rodească. De aceea mănăstirile noastre sunt niște vase, niște locuri speciale pentru rugăciune. Noi am ieșit din lume, dar trăim pentru lume.
We've been granted a rare chance to meet with Archbishop Justinian.
He's the presiding bishop for Maramureș in Transylvania, a well-loved high priest and former abbot of St. Anna Monastery at Rochia.
În cultul bisericii noastre există o cântare foarte importantă, care începe așa. Așa se cântă, toată grija ce lumească de la noi să le pădăm. Când intră un creștincios, un drept creștincios în biserică, toată grija lumească rămâne afară. Și se reculege și își îndreaptă toate gândurile și toată atenția spre cuvântul preotului, spre liturghie. Un creștin mirian, laic, sau un monah, un călugăr, sau un pusnic, un sihastru, când decide să se roage, adică să stea de vorbă cu Dumnezeu, cade atunci în genunchi, toate gândurile le alungă, faci o liniște desăvârșită, o liniște spirituală desăvârșită și atunci începe să vorbească cu Dumnezeu. Atunci rugăciunea lui este o rugăciune reală. În afară de această rugăciune reală, sunt și rugăciunile formale, care le facem la slujbă, dar sunt formale. Rugăciunea adevărată aceasta este, adică reculezi total, eliberat total de toată grijă lumească, îndreptându-ți gândul și toate forțele tale intelectuale și spirituale și credința. Că tu nu vorbești în gol, ci tu vorbești cu Dumnezeu. Dumnezeu în fața mea. Nu-L văd, dar-L cunosc lângă mine. Îi văd urechea cum mă ascultă. Aceasta este, aceasta e nevoie să învețe lumea. Că lumea a uitat să se roage.
We next visit a Capilla monastery, a convent. 1,000 nuns live here.
When you are tonsured in monasticism, you receive, among other garment habits,
yes,
you receive this. And it is called, take, brother or sister, take this sword of the Holy Spirit. And always, whenever you go and you walk, and when during the time you eat and so on, and even in your sleep, always to say this, to recite this prayer: Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy upon me, sinner, son of God.
Could lay people say that prayer?
Of course, everybody. But I heard fathers, spiritual, renowned, famous spiritual fathers, even by radio, they say everybody should tell this, recite this prayer. Why not?
Could you please tell us of your experience in union with God?
Everyone, everybody who practice this ascetic prayer, this mental prayer, I suppose is very discreet. It's not possible to openly discuss about the delights or the blessedness of meeting with the bride.
It's like a bridegroom. A secret wisdom.
Yes, I think so.
We meet Mother Elisaya, who encourages us to spread God's love to others.
So all she said all her life was, Lord have mercy on me, a sinner. All she said all her life was, Lord have mercy on me, a sinner. All she said all her life was, Lord have mercy on me, a sinner.
We visit the central church of northern Romania in Iași. We are honored with a special meeting with the Metropolitan, His Eminence Archbishop Daniil.
After seeing so many icons on our journey, we asked the Metropolitan, how is it possible to connect the use of external objects like icons to the internal experience of prayer?
True prayer is prayer without imagination, without forms, without images. And at the same time, the Orthodox churches and especially monasteries are plenty of icons. I think because what is important in the icon is not only the face of Christ or of Virgin Mary or of the saints, but the light beyond. The important attitude is to remind us that we are in the presence of God and to start to speak with Him also silently, not just by word. And this communion of our mind with God, it's the beginning of a good prayer, although we are in the cities or we are working in the office. And it's a question of desire to meet God and to let God share in our life. The prayer is not only our activity. It's the activity of God in us, and especially when we see around us many people suffering. We feel the duty to become more and more the hands of Christ, helping those who need our help, and to discover the icon of Christ in the suffering of our fellow humans.
Back in the city, a recurring question lingers in our minds. How can we translate the peace of these monastics to the busyness of our modern lives? Soon after, we have the unexpected grace of an audience with the Patriarch of all Romania, His Beatitude Theoctist.
It's a rare moment. To meet someone with such great power and holiness, it's like meeting with a pope.
Soon after our meeting, he was to pass away in the Lord, and Archbishop Daniel succeeded to his place.
Și zic, mulți dintre semenii noștri, nu pot să cred, nu pot să mă rog. Bătrânul părinte, când i-a spus tânărul, că la ce folosește rugăciunea? Că mă rog și parcă nu mă rog, nu simt foloasele ei. Bătrânul atunci i-a spus fratelui tânăr să ia un ciur, un coș de nuiele făcute din smicele și să-i aducă apă. Și venea, scotea și ciurul mai ia o dată și mai ia o dată și tot așa. Privește la coș, este același coș ca înainte de a-l băga în apă, coșul era rat, strălucea. Hey, vezi puterea rugăciunii.
So this is the power of prayer. It cleans.
Da.
As monasticism spread from the Mediterranean countries, it moved north to the Slavic lands, Ukraine and Russia.
Это, собственно, постоянная молитва. Вне молитвы монах уже монахом не является. Вне молитвы это монах не молящийся, это просто человек, носящий черные одежды. Молитва, и в частности Иисусова молитва, которая является основным деланием монаха, это делание, которое передается по наследству, передается от старца к ученику. И, к сожалению, в советское время эта преемственность была утрачена. Да, я пришел в монастырь перед самым развалом Советского Союза. Но вот в те времена, когда советская власть была в силе, естественно, между словом «монах» и между словом «мученик» можно было ставить знак равенства.
Преподобные отцы наши зверинецкие, молите Бога о нас.
This cave named Погребальная. A lot of monks' graves are there. You see some relics. It's relics of monks 11th, 12th century. They know only one or two prayers. One of those prayers was Господи Иисусе Христе, Сыне Божий, помилуй меня грешного, в простоте глубина. And these easy words, very big deepness. This is cave church named Archangel Mikhail, Saint Michael. Two place for sitting. Ancient monk prayers some 4, 5, or even 10 hours. It's very, very hard with their diseases to stay in this church, so they have some rest for their legs, but not for their mind and their hand.
Ублажаем, ублажаем.
It's only a short jaunt by air from Kiev to Moscow.
We're on our way, heading for the main monastery of all Russia, Sergiev Posad.
We turn back now to speak to Father Jacob, one of the spiritual teachers and professor of Hebrew scripture at St. Sergei's monastery.
One of the fathers said that prayer is the life of the soul, and yet today many people encounter Christianity almost as if there is no prayer within it. They need a formal aspect of Christianity.
You see that it's a tragedy of the Western world, because the multitude of people which are living here have lost this treasury of pure Christianity. That's why it became tradition. Jesus' prayer, this is not only tradition, but it's the core, the string of our monastic being from the very beginning of the life inside these walls, in ourselves, in our divine services, in our relations, in our words, in our even breathing of this air. The quietness of heart, the peace of heart, it's not the main idea or the main aim of this process, of this praying. No, it's the foundation. We should realize that in the next hour I can die, but my heart, my feelings, my soul, my body, my brains belong to Christ. That's why I'm not afraid of this world, of temptations, of sorrows, of difficulties. No, our feeling is that you can die tomorrow. And that's why we are free in God. It's the very optimistic feeling.
The Jesus prayer initially was practiced in the caves. Now it can be practiced in the modern caves of people living in blocks, in apartments, in big cities, being busy, but having also reserved some private space in their hearts, in their minds for Jesus prayer. It's not the place where a person lives, it's the way the person lives which matters. It goes back to the saying of the scripture, to the above the commandment and the teaching of Jesus when he said that everyone who calls my name will be saved.
God is always present, and that's something that I'm always aware of. My relationship with God is in these words, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
The Jesus prayer,
yeah. That encompasses everything.
Господи, Иисусе Христе, Сыне Божий, помилуй меня грешного. Господи, Иисусе Христе, Сыне Божий, помилуй меня грешного. Господи 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 Иисусе Христе, Сыне Божий.